In 1965 and 1966, 10 teams of astronauts journeyed into Earth orbit on some of the most spectacular missions in spaceflight history. The voyages of Project Gemini were the boldest, the longest, and the most ambitious space flights of their time. Gemini astronauts were among the first to walk in space, floating at the end of a golden tether more than 100 miles above the Earth.
That's beautiful. I feel like $1 million.
They became runners in the first space marathons, living in orbit for up to 2 full weeks. And they perfected the art of space rendezvous, in which one spacecraft chases down another in a complex orbital ballet. For NASA, these achievements were crucial steps on the road to the moon. Gemini's success cleared the way for the astronauts of Project Apollo to make history's first voyages to another world. And yet, for all its accomplishments, Gemini has often been overshadowed by the trailblazing Mercury missions that came before it and the Apollo moon landings that came after. Today, few people remember Gemini's achievements. And fewer have seen the remarkable film footage you are about to see.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
In 1961, when President John F. Kennedy challenged the nation to put a man on the moon by the end of the decade, NASA was suddenly faced with an enormous task. At that time, just one American had been in space, and his flight had been a 15-minute suborbital hop. Now, Kennedy was giving NASA less than 9 years to send astronauts beyond Earth to another celestial body. Before anyone could go to the moon, NASA had to solve some crucial unknowns. Could humans survive in space long enough to make a round-trip flight to the moon? Could they control their spacecraft to make the maneuvers required for a lunar mission? Could they venture safely into the vacuum of space, just as they would have to do to walk on the moon? These were questions that the relatively simple Mercury missions would not answer. NASA needed to build a bridge between the pioneering Mercury flights and the awesome challenges of the lunar landing. That bridge became Project Gemini. Even before Kennedy's lunar challenge, NASA and McDonnell Aircraft, builder of the Mercury spacecraft, were thinking ahead to an improved version of Mercury, which they called Mercury Mark II. So by the time Project Gemini was approved in mid-1961, the craft's design was already largely thought out. The Gemini spacecraft, named for the constellation representing the twins Castor and Pollux, would include 3 main sections. The bell-shaped re-entry module would contain the pressurized crew cabin, along with rocket thrusters used during re-entry, and the craft's recovery system for landing on Earth. The retrograde section would house the 4 solid-fuel retro rockets. The equipment section would include the astronauts' main oxygen supply, fuel and rocket thrusters for maneuvering in orbit, and the craft's electrical power supply, which would be provided on early missions by batteries and later by fuel cells. At first glance, Gemini looked like a larger version of Mercury, but looks were deceiving. Gemini was to be far more sophisticated than its predecessor. It would be the first spacecraft with the ability to change its own orbit and the first capable of rendezvous in space. And while the Mercury was designed to stay in space little more than a day, Gemini would be capable of missions lasting 2 weeks. To propel Gemini into space, NASA chose the Air Force's Titan II ballistic missile. At liftoff, the Titan's first stage engines would produce 430,000 pounds of thrust, more than 1.5 times the amount of power of the Atlas booster used in Mercury. 2.5 minutes after launch, the Titan's second stage with 100,000 pounds of thrust would take over and place Gemini in orbit. But before Gemini could reach space, NASA and its contractors had to solve some daunting technical problems. The Gemini spacecraft's power-producing fuel cells were giving engineers one headache after another. So were the craft's maneuvering thrusters and its launch escape system. And the Titan booster had so many failures during its first few test launches that NASA began to wonder whether the rocket would ever be safe enough for astronauts. The most troubling problem was sudden surges in acceleration as the Titan flew. Something the engineers called pogo. It caused rapid and violent oscillations, as if the rocket were bouncing like a pogo stick. In a Gemini launch, these vibrations could interfere with the astronauts' ability to read their instruments. And on some test flights, pogo was so bad it caused one of the first stage rocket engines to shut down prematurely, an event that could have aborted a Gemini mission. By late 1963, however, engineers were beginning to solve the pogo problem. But another troubling element of the Gemini program would not be resolved: the proposed paraglider landing system. The direct ancestor of today's hang gliders, the paraglider used an inflatable Regalo wing to let the spacecraft glide to a landing on a desert runway. NASA tested the paraglider, but found the concept unworkable for Gemini. Gemini would use parachutes to splash down in the ocean, just as Mercury had done. Finally, it was time for Gemini's maiden voyage. On April 8, 1964, the unmanned Gemini 1 lifted off Pad 19 at Florida's Kennedy Space Center. The Titan worked nearly perfectly, sending Gemini 1 into an orbit ranging from 100 miles to 199 miles above the Earth. After three orbits, NASA declared the flight a success. Gemini 1 continued to circle the globe until April 12th, when friction with the atmosphere caused the craft to plunge back to Earth in a fiery destruction. A second unpiloted Gemini flight came on January 19th, 1965.
3, 2, 1, 0.
Hurled Gemini 2 onto a suborbital trajectory designed to test the craft's heat shield. After soaring to a height of 100 miles, the craft slammed back into the atmosphere, enduring the most severe heating any Gemini was likely to face. Once again, everything worked as planned, and NASA scored another Gemini success. Now it was time for men to ride Gemini into space. And by this time, there were more than 24 astronauts anxious to fly it. 9 new astronauts had been selected for Gemini and Apollo missions in 1962, and 14 more joined the astronaut corps in 1963. Each of them went through intensive training to qualify for space missions. There was survival training in both desert and jungle conditions, in case the Gemini came down off target. There was classroom instruction in such arcane subjects as digital computers and orbital mechanics. And because the astronauts would not only fly Gemini, but help develop and test the spacecraft, they spent hour after hour studying the craft's many systems and components. Every one of the astronauts wanted to be the first to fly Gemini into space, but there could be only two. NASA chose veteran astronaut Gus Grissom to command Gemini's manned debut. In 1961, Grissom had piloted the second manned Mercury mission, a suborbital flight that almost ended in disaster. After splashdown in the Atlantic, the hatch of Grissom's capsule prematurely blew off and the craft flooded with water. Grissom narrowly escaped drowning. His spacecraft sank to the bottom of the Atlantic. With a mischievous sense of irony, Grissom nicknamed Gemini 3 after the heroine of a popular Broadway play, the unsinkable Molly Brown. Grissom's co-pilot, a rookie named John Young, was one of the new nine picked in 1962. Together, they had been training for the flight of Gemini 3 for almost a year. Early in the morning of March 23, 1965, Grissom and Young suited up and rode the elevator at pad 19 to board Gemini 3. Each man took his place in the Gemini's cramped cockpit, and then technicians sealed the two hatches shut. At 9:24 a.m., the Titan's engines ignited, and Grissom and Young headed for space with a special send-off from Capcom Gordon Cooper.
There goes the pitch.
Roger pitch. You're on your way, Molly Brown.
Yeah, man.
As the Titan climbed toward space, everyone hoped the booster would behave. In the event of a catastrophic failure during launch, Gemini was equipped with ejection seats. But after the first minute of the flight, Gemini 3 was already traveling at supersonic speeds, heading for the outer fringes of the atmosphere. Most NASA insiders assumed that punching out under such conditions wasn't survivable, but the Titan performed beautifully. Just 5.5 minutes after liftoff, the Titan's second stage engine shut down and Gemini 3 was in orbit. For the next 5 hours, Grissom and Young put Gemini 3 through its paces and found it spaceworthy. And they scored an important first. Three times during the mission, they fired their maneuvering thrusters to change Gemini 3's orbit. During the third orbit, Grissom and Young cast off the equipment section and then fired the retro rockets to begin the journey back to Earth. Because the craft did not produce as much lift during re-entry as had been predicted, Gemini 3 splashed down some 50 miles off target. Thankfully, the unsinkable Molly Brown lived up to its name, but in Young's words, it was no boat. After pitching and rolling in the Atlantic for half an hour, he and Grissom were glad to be hoisted aboard the recovery helicopter and taken to the carrier Intrepid. The cheers of sailors on the carrier's deck were matched by celebrations at NASA. The manned phase of the Gemini program was off to a great start. For all of Gemini's growing successes, it seemed the U.S. was still behind in the space race with the Soviet Union. In 1957, the Soviets had launched the first artificial satellite, and in 1961, the first man in space. They'd also achieved the first woman in space and the first multi-person spaceflight. And in March 1965, just a few days before the launch of Gemini 3, there was another Soviet space spectacular when cosmonaut Alexei Leonov became the first person to walk in space. For 10 minutes, Leonov floated outside the Voskhod 2 spacecraft. It seemed the Soviets' momentum in space was unstoppable. But Gemini astronauts were about to do some catching up. On June 3, 1965, Gemini 4 reached orbit carrying rookie astronauts Jim McDivitt and Ed White for a four-day mission. The flight would be the longest U.S. space mission yet, almost three times as long as the 34-hour flight of Mercury astronaut Gordon Cooper 2 years earlier. But the highlight of the mission came during the third orbit, when White opened the right-hand hatch of Gemini 4 and emerged into a sunlit void. A new term entered the space lexicon: extravehicular activity, or EVA.
Okay, I'm dead right from the spacecraft.
The first time I tried to come out, there I go. All right, now I'm leaving, and it's under the influence of the gun. I'm trying to maneuver over to my left so I would be in front of Jim's window. I maneuvered approximately down the center line of the spacecraft, perhaps favoring just a little on the right.
For White's EVA, NASA had developed a handheld maneuvering unit, informally known as the Zip Gun, powered by compressed gas. Now, as he floated free, White fired the gun and propelled himself away from Gemini 4.
I'm above the spacecraft. I'm coming back down now. I'm under my own control.
It was like something out of Buck Rogers, but it was real.
Okay, I'm coming over.
It looks beautiful.
I feel like $1 million.
For 23 minutes, White floated alongside Gemini 4 like a human satellite, while McDivitt snapped some of the most memorable photographs in the history of spaceflight. The maneuvering unit soon ran out of fuel, But that didn't dampen the spirits of America's first spacewalker, who was having so much fun that he seemed reluctant to end his spacewalk despite the urging of Capcom Gus Grissom.
This is Jim. What's your message for us?
The flight director says get back in.
Okay.
One. Where are we over now?
No, we're coming over the west end. They want you to come back in.
Back in?
Back in.
Roger, we've been trying to talk to you for a while here.
Coming in.
Only one problem marred the otherwise spectacularly successful EVA. When White tried to close his hatch, the latching mechanism refused to engage. For several tense moments, White struggled with the hatch until finally it latched shut. Almost 4 days later, McDivitt and White returned to Earth, tired but healthy, proving to NASA doctors that astronauts could handle long-duration space missions. And the next Gemini crew would stretch that endurance limit even farther in an 8-day space marathon. With the success of Gemini 4's walk in space, NASA moved on to another of Gemini's primary objectives: long-duration flights to prove astronauts could survive a lunar voyage. For Gemini 5, Mercury veteran Gordon Cooper and rookie Pete Conrad would attempt to spend 8 days in orbit. The mission would be an endurance test, not only for the men, but for the Gemini spacecraft and its complex systems. Gemini 5's crew greeted the challenge with characteristic enthusiasm. Gordon Cooper had already logged a 34-hour Mercury mission, the longest U.S. space flight until Gemini 4. And Pete Conrad, who had been branded as unsuitable for long-duration flight by psychologists during his selection as an astronaut, was anxious to prove the shrinks wrong. Their confidence was reflected in the mission emblem they chose for Gemini 5. It showed a covered wagon, a reference to the pioneers who settled the American West, bearing the motto, 8 days or bust. When NASA managers protested, saying the slogan would make the agency look bad if the flight didn't achieve its intended duration, Cooper and Conrad simply covered the words with blank cloth, which they planned to remove after splashdown, if they made their 8 days or bust goal. On August 21st, 1965, Cooper and Conrad lifted off. For the first and only time during a Gemini launch, the Titan booster developed pogo oscillations, subjecting the crew to vibrations of more than one-third of a G. Thankfully, the pogo disappeared shortly before the rocket's first stage was jettisoned and caused no real problems. But real problems were waiting for Cooper and Conrad almost as soon as they reached orbit. They concerned Gemini 5's electrical power system, which utilized a new type of device called a fuel cell. Used in space for the first time on Gemini 5, the fuel cells produced electricity by combining hydrogen and oxygen stored in tanks in the craft's equipment section. They were known as temperamental devices, and they started acting up early in the mission. If they quit, Gemini 5 would have only its onboard batteries to supply power, and that meant the mission would soon be terminated. But after an intensive review of the situation in Houston, Mission Control decided the flight could continue. Then, on the mission's fifth day, the spacecraft's maneuvering thrusters began acting up. Cooper and Conrad were forced to let their spacecraft drift for the rest of the mission, sometimes tumbling slowly in space. Even without their onboard systems troubles, Cooper and Conrad faced a major challenge, simply living for 8 days in Gemini's tiny cabin. Each man, wearing his bulky spacesuit, had about as much space as a phone booth. The food they ate was mostly dehydrated items, which were reconstituted using cold water. There would be no hot meals on Gemini. There was no way to take a shower or put on clean clothes, and the bathroom facilities were rudimentary, to say the least. Urine was dumped overboard via a collection hose. And for defecation, there were plastic bags with adhesive edges, which were sealed with germicide tablets and stored for return to Earth. No wonder that Conrad later described the mission as 8 days in a garbage can.
Mr. Flight Director, would like to speak to you for just a moment. Good morning, Gordo.
Yes, how are you?
How does it feel for the United States to be the new record holder?
At last, huh?
Roger. Congratulations.
But when Gemini 5 splashed down on August 29th, after 8 days in space, everyone knew it had all been worth it. Cooper and Conrad became the world's space endurance champions. Within days, doctors knew the men had come through their space marathon in good condition. And NASA had chalked up another crucial milestone on the road to the moon. By the fall of 1965, NASA was ready to tackle Gemini's most important objective, space rendezvous. During the Apollo moon landings, two astronauts returning from the surface of the moon would have to rejoin their orbiting crewmate using space rendezvous techniques. But NASA couldn't afford to wait until the Apollo missions to prove that those techniques would actually work. Gemini astronauts would have to show this by chasing down an unmanned Agena target rocket already in Earth orbit. For Gemini 6, Mercury veteran Wally Schirra and rookie Tom Stafford were given the plum assignment of being the first to carry out this crucial demonstration. But plans changed on October 25th, when the Agena target rocket was launched atop an Atlas booster. The Agena never made it to space. Shortly after separating from the Atlas, the Agena had disintegrated. The mission was scrubbed.
The Agena vehicle went into the Atlantic some 5,500 miles short of the desired velocity.
But a plan soon emerged to salvage the rendezvous mission. Instead of an Agena target rocket, Gemini 6 could rendezvous with another Gemini.
We as a crew naturally were prepared for rendezvous sometime on the 25th of October and had no real prediction on when we would accomplish rendezvous until this plan was dusted off and brought to the attention of the appropriate people in management. And then, of course, when we were drawn into the loop for our comments, we immediately responded with great elation. So we didn't even get near the term so-called despondent. We were disappointed when we left the Cape and elated by the time we were in Houston about 4 hours.
The two-week mission of Gemini 7 with rookies Frank Borman and Jim Lovell was slated to begin in early December. According to the new plan, Schirra and Stafford would be launched days later in Gemini 6 to rendezvous with Gemini 7. It meant the two missions would have to be launched in record time, less than 2 weeks apart. But NASA decided it could be done. On December 4th, 1965, Borman and Lovell left Earth to begin their space marathon. Many of their tasks centered on a number of medical tests to determine the effects of prolonged weightlessness. Like Gemini 5's Cooper and Conrad, the pair found that the cramped Gemini was no hotel. Aside from the lack of space, the cabin was too warm. Even though they were wearing new, lightweight spacesuits created specially for the mission, both men complained of discomfort. 45 hours into the flight, Lovell was given permission to strip down to his long johns. But mission control had directed that one crewman remain suited at all times in case there was a loss of cabin pressure. So while Lovell enjoyed his newfound comfort, Borman sweated out the hours in space.
And I looked over at Frank, who was well suited up there, and I didn't want to tell him how nice it was. Because he looked so happy the way he was.
But these were the only real troubles during the flight's first week. On the flight's seventh day, Borman even got to take off his suit. That is, after Lovell had put his back on. By then, it was almost time for the highlight of the mission, a visit from Gemini 6. On Earth, Schirra and Stafford were ready to attempt the first space rendezvous. But could they pull it off? 6 months earlier, Gemini 4 astronauts had tried to rendezvous with a spent upper stage of their Titan booster and discovered how difficult it was. The laws of orbital mechanics meant flying a space rendezvous was nothing like flying an airplane. When the Gemini 5 crew practiced a limited set of rendezvous maneuvers during their flight, NASA was encouraged that a real rendezvous could be achieved. But until Gemini 6 actually flew next to Gemini 7, no one could be sure. On December 12th, everything was ready. Schirra and Stafford were sealed inside Gemini 6, waiting for their Titan booster to ignite and propel them into orbit. When the count reached zero, the engines lit, and a moment later, they fell silent.
We have a shutdown, Jimmy 6.
My clock has started.
No liftoff.
Verify program reset.
No liftoff.
Inside Gemini 6, 100 feet above the launch pad, Wally Schirra faced a life-or-death decision. The mission clock on the instrument panel had started ticking. But had the Titan lifted off? If so, it was about to come crashing down and explode in a ball of flame. By pulling a D-ring between his knees, Schirra could trigger the ejection seats for both men. Ejecting at such low altitude would be hazardous, but staying put could be deadly. Despite the ticking mission clock, Schirra decided to trust the seat of his pants, which told him the rocket had not lifted off.
My hands were on it. They were supposed to be. And it's kind of a fast 1.5 seconds for us. The sneaky part was the clock starting, which is not supposed to happen until liftoff. So we did have a couple of quiet, trying seconds there, I guess. But nothing moved, and this is probably the best part, so we didn't either.
While ground controllers intently studied the situation, Schirra and Stafford did nothing. The decision paid off. The rocket had never lifted off, and Schirra and Stafford were safe. Technicians later traced the failure to a dust cap that had accidentally been left on one of the Titan's engine valves, causing the rocket to shut down 1.2 seconds after ignition. And the decision not to eject had also saved another chance to launch Gemini 6 in time to catch Gemini 7. Finally, on December 15th, Gemini 6 rose from the launch pad. Minutes after reaching orbit, Schirra and Stafford were ready to begin their hunt for Gemini 7, which was then some 1,200 miles ahead. For 5 hours, the pair executed a precise series of maneuvers, aided by their onboard computer and information from Mission Control, to make Gemini 6's orbit coincide with Gemini 7's. At last, they spotted Gemini 7 in the distance, glowing in the sunlight like a bright star. With Gemini 7 still 270 miles away, Gemini 6's rendezvous radar locked onto its target. And then, Schirra and Stafford closed in until the two spacecraft were flying in formation together over the Pacific.
Right now, 6 is about 10 feet above and to the left of 7. We're just flying nose-to-nose, approximately 15 feet apart.
Schirra steered Gemini 6 to within a foot of Gemini 7, close enough for him and Stafford to see the faces of their bearded companions. For 6 hours, the two space crews flew side by side, taking pictures and talking by radio. Then, Gemini 6 backed away, fired its retro rockets, and returned to Earth after a day in space. The first space rendezvous was now history. NASA had chalked up Gemini's greatest accomplishment. For Borman and Lovell, the departure of Gemini 6 left them alone in orbit for another 3 days. Low on maneuvering fuel, they let the spacecraft drift, simply enduring the wait to come home. And like the Gemini 5 crew before them, they struggled with their bulky fuel cells, hoping the temperamental power plants would hold out long enough to complete the 14-day mission. Frank Borman would later call it the longest 3 days of his life. Finally, on December 18th, Borman and Lovell returned to Earth, splashing down 700 miles southwest of Bermuda. Standing on the deck of the recovery ship USS Wasp, the men felt the pull of gravity for the first time in 2 weeks. But soon, medical exam showed that the pair had come through their marathon in good condition.
We then were submitted to the, thrown to the doctors, and we recovered 10 hours later in fine shape.
Borman and Lovell were the iron men of spaceflight, and their mission had shown beyond a doubt that humans could handle a lunar voyage. With most of Gemini's major objectives accomplished, NASA was now ready to move on to more ambitious flights, including the first rendezvous and docking missions, more spacewalks, and a host of other space experiments. Five more Gemini missions were planned for 1966. These missions would bring the Gemini program to a spectacular finale, and they would provide some of the most harrowing moments in spaceflight history. As 1966 opened, Project Gemini had racked up an impressive list of accomplishments, including the world's first space rendezvous and a new spaceflight endurance record of 2 weeks. In the space race between the United States and the Soviet Union, the U.S. was pulling ahead of its rival. And NASA felt a growing confidence that the challenges of landing a man on the moon by the end of the decade could be met. For Project Gemini, it was time to step up the pace of activities with a series of brief but hectic missions. The upcoming three-day Gemini 8 mission typified the ambitious nature of these flights. Dave Scott would take a two-hour spacewalk using a handheld maneuvering gun, powered by a special backpack, to propel himself through space. But the highlight of the mission would come at the beginning, when Scott and his commander, fellow space rookie Neil Armstrong, would attempt the first docking between two space vehicles. That was something the Soviets hadn't even tried. But engineers were unsure if the Agena was a reliable spacecraft. Already, the Agena for Gemini 6 had blown up before reaching orbit, canceling the planned rendezvous and docking on that flight. But when it came time to launch Gemini 8's Agena, at 10 a.m. on the morning of March 16, 1966, everything went perfectly. Just 41 minutes later, Armstrong and Scott lifted off to follow the Agena into orbit. As soon as they reached space, Armstrong and Scott began preparations for the rendezvous. Just as the Gemini 6 crew had done, they steered their spacecraft through a precise series of maneuvers until, 6 hours into the mission, they reached their quarry. For about half an hour, Armstrong carefully flew Gemini 8 closer to the Agena, while Scott inspected the target rocket. Then, Armstrong steered the spacecraft's nose into the docking collar at the end of the Agena, and for the first time, two spacecraft were joined in orbit. In space and in mission control, there was jubilation. But the high was short-lived. Soon after passing out of range of the tracking station in Antananarivo, Madagascar, Armstrong and Scott noticed that they weren't flying the way they should. Their instruments told them that the joined spacecraft were slowly spinning. Within minutes, the spin worsened. In darkness and out of contact with ground stations, the men grappled with a problem. While Scott sent commands to turn off the Agena's control system, Armstrong struggled with the Gemini's thrusters. But nothing they did solved the problem. With no help from mission control, the astronauts decided to undock and analyze the problem. Scott hit the undocking button, and Armstrong quickly backed away from the Agena. But that only made things worse. With the heavy Agena no longer attached, Gemini 8 began tumbling wildly. Armstrong and Scott realized that the problem lay not with the Agena, but with their own spacecraft. One of the Gemini's 16 maneuvering thrusters was firing on its own. Now, as the ship Coastal Sentry Quebec made radio contact with Gemini 8, Mission Control learned of the emergency in space.
Gemini 8, CSQ.com, contact Addy Reed.
We got serious problems here with this forward tumbling end over end, but we're disengaged from the Agena.
For long minutes, Armstrong struggled to isolate the malfunctioning thruster without success. As Gemini 8 whirled at one revolution every second, the astronauts' vision began to blur and narrow. If the high-speed tumble continued much longer, they were in danger of losing consciousness. With their normal supply of maneuvering fuel running low, the men made a fateful decision. Armstrong switched to another set of thrusters, reserved for re-entry. Soon, he was able to stop the spin, but mission rules said the flight had to come to an end as quickly as possible. That meant coming down in the Pacific in one of NASA's contingency landing areas. Armstrong worried that he and Scott might come down in some remote wilderness, but there was no other choice. And so after just 10 hours in space, the men fired their retro rockets and began their fiery journey back to Earth. Gemini 8 splashed down in rough seas some 500 miles east of Okinawa. Armstrong and Scott were picked up by the destroyer USS Mason, tired and nauseated from their ordeal, but otherwise in good condition. And so Gemini 8 had given NASA the first real crisis of the Gemini program. But with the first space docking, it had also provided one of the program's most important successes. Engineers soon found a way to prevent a thruster malfunction from threatening future Gemini missions. And plans were already underway to use the Agena's capabilities to propel future Gemini astronauts to new heights. The story of Gemini 9 began with tragedy. On February 28, 1966, the crew of Gemini 9, rookies Elliot C. and Charlie Bassett, were killed when their T-38 jet struck the roof of a building at the McDonnell plant as they were coming in to land during a snowstorm. Ironically, the building contained the Gemini 9 spacecraft they were to fly.
We know at this point only that they were making an approach, instrument approach landing at the municipal airport, and apparently struck one of the McDonnell Aircraft Company buildings. And what caused this to happen, we have no idea at this point, and this will be one of the things the investigating board is trying to find out.
After the deaths of C. and Bassett, NASA called on the backup crew for the mission, veteran Tom Stafford and rookie Gene Cernan. Together, they would carry out a mission designed to build on Gemini's past accomplishments. The pair would test new techniques for space rendezvous, more like the ones envisioned for Apollo moon missions. And Cernan would become the second American to walk in space, testing a rocket-powered backpack developed by the Air Force. Called the Astronaut Maneuvering Unit, or AMU, it could be useful to future astronauts repairing a satellite in orbit or building a space station. But Stafford and Cernan had a hard time just getting off the ground. Their first launch attempt on May 17, 1966 was scrubbed when their Agena target rocket failed to reach space, this time because of a malfunction of its Atlas booster. Gemini managers decided to send up a backup target that was waiting in the wings. Called the Augmented Target Docking Adapter, or ATDA, it lacked the Agena's rocket engine, but would allow the astronauts to practice rendezvous and docking. 2 days later, Stafford and Cernan finally soared into orbit. But when they caught up with the ATDA, they learned something had gone wrong. The protective shroud that covered the nose of the ATDA during launch had failed to separate once the craft reached orbit. And now, as Stafford described it, the ATDA was hardly safe for docking with. Anxious to fix the problem, Stafford suggested to Mission Control that he dislodge the half-open shroud by tapping it with a docking bar on Gemini 9's nose. But that idea didn't sit well with NASA managers. While Mission Control debated what to do, Stafford and Cernan photographed their angry alligator, then backed away to a distance of 13 miles. If they couldn't dock with the ATDA, they could still use it to practice rendezvous techniques. And that they did, this time pretending their rendezvous radar had conked out, relying instead on information from their onboard computer, star sightings with a sextant, and their own eyes. The exercise was successful. Once again, they were nose to nose with a slowly spinning beast. But the intensity of their first day in space had left Stafford and Cernan all but exhausted. Cernan's spacewalk had been planned for the following day, but when Houston suggested postponing it until the flight's third day, Stafford heartily agreed. And so on Sunday, June 5th, Gene Cernan emerged from Gemini 9's cabin and floated into the void. Wearing a special chest pack to regulate his oxygen supply, Cernan planned to remain outside for more than 3 hours. But as he struggled with his 25-foot umbilical, Cernan realized that walking in space was much more difficult than he'd expected from simulations. Working in weightlessness was like being in a three-dimensional ice skating rink. The slightest pull of the tether or push against the spacecraft set his body tumbling. It was just as Isaac Newton had written in his third law of motion. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. On Earth, we don't always notice this effect, but in weightlessness, it becomes an overwhelming fact of life. Cernan's troubles only worsened as he made his way along Gemini 9's hull to the aft equipment section, where the astronaut maneuvering unit was waiting for him. The plan was for Cernan to strap himself into the AMU and activate its systems. Then, once Stafford flipped a switch, Cernan would be released to fly free on his own. The legs of Cernan's spacesuit had been modified with steel fabric as protection from the hot exhaust of the AMU's thrusters.
The handrail in the back is out. Good. A little back, but I may be able to get this one. Handrail is deployed. Okay, come on there, you turn.
That is, if Cernan could get that far. But now, as Cernan tried to activate the AMU, his heart pounded with the exertion of working in his stiff, pressurized spacesuit. The restraints designed to keep him from floating away from his work didn't do the job. With the blazing sun beating down on his back, Cernan became overheated. Moisture from his breath and perspiration overloaded the environmental control system in his chest pack. As Gemini 9 flew into another orbital night, Cernan's visor began to fog. Soon he could barely see. It was time to end what Cernan would later call the spacewalk from hell. Stafford called down to the communications station in Hawaii.
About 4 or 5 times more work than what we anticipated, and the pilot's visor is completely fogged over, nearly frozen over.
Okay, he said he's getting extreme fogging on his visor and trying to freeze up, and also that he was having quite a bit of trouble reading it. The pilot was fairly garbled.
Cernan struggled to see through his fogged faceplate as he made his way back to the safety of Gemini 9's cabin. One final ordeal awaited him there, squeezing his pressure-suited body into the tiny cabin and closing the hatch. Only with Stafford's help did the hatch finally lock into place. By then, Cernan was overheated and nearly exhausted. In Mission Control, Flight Director Gene Kranz breathed a sigh of relief. And when Gemini 9 splashed down, NASA knew they had once again averted disaster in space. Cernan's spacewalk had revealed a troubling lack of understanding about how to handle the ice skating rink of zero G. It was a problem that would come up yet again as Gemini moved on to another ambitious mission. For Gemini 10, NASA once again focused on the twin objectives of space rendezvous and spacewalks. Veteran John Young and rookie Mike Collins would try to rendezvous with not one, but two target rockets, an Agena launched specially for their own mission, and the Agena from Gemini 8, which was still in orbit. And Collins would make two EVAs, including one to the Agena 8, to retrieve an experiment package from its hull. But when Young and Collins left Earth on July 18th, they ran into some unexpected problems as they began their hunt for Agena 10. The astronauts had planned to calculate the maneuvers for the rendezvous using their own navigation sightings, along with data from the onboard computer. As Gemini 10 flew into orbital night, Collins used a handheld sextant to sight on stars, measuring their apparent distance from the Earth's darkened horizon. But Collins found that instead of the distinct horizon, he was seeing stars through a fuzzy, glowing band of atmosphere called the air glow. This new wrinkle made it difficult for Collins to keep up with the rapid-fire pace required for the rendezvous calculations. In the end, the men had to use figures computed by Mission Control. 4.5 hours after launch, Gemini 10 began its final approach to the Agena. But as Young tried to close the gap, he realized there was an error in Gemini 10's flight path. To reach the target, Young had to use almost twice as much fuel as planned. Only later would the astronauts find out they hadn't precisely aligned their spacecraft's guidance platform for the rendezvous, causing the error in their trajectory. But as Young and Collins docked with the Agena, there was no time to dwell on the past. Soon after docking, the astronauts prepared to fire their Agena's engine to start a new rendezvous, this time with the Agena 8, which was in an orbit some 100 miles above Gemini 10. To reach it, they would use the propulsion system on their Agena 10, a rocket engine with 16,000 pounds of thrust. Collins entered a sequence of numbers into a special encoder to send the command to the Agena for the rocket firing. Then, with a bright orange-white flash, the engine came to life.
When that baby lights, there's no doubt about it.
The burn lasted 14 seconds, enough time for the Agena to send Young and Collins soaring to a height of 475 miles over the South Atlantic, a new world altitude record. After a fitful night's sleep, the astronauts fired their Agena's engine again to adjust their orbit closer to that of Agena 8. And then, Collins made the first of two planned EVAs. For over 40 minutes, he stood in Gemini 10's open hatch, taking ultraviolet photographs of the heavens and marveling at the starry vista all around him. The successful spacewalk was marred only by an irritating substance in the astronauts' oxygen supply that caused both men's eyes to water. The problem went away as soon as Collins was back inside Gemini 10. On their third day in space, Young and Collins used the Agena 10 to make two small adjustments to their orbit. Then they undocked, leaving behind the Agena 10 to begin the final stage in the hunt for Agena 8. Because it was now a dead spacecraft with no way to provide any return to Gemini's radar signals, the rendezvous with Agena 8 was even trickier for Young and Collins than their first one. But this time, there were no problems, and soon the Agena 8 loomed before them. Meanwhile, Collins had been preparing for his second spacewalk to retrieve an experiment package, a micrometeorite collector, from the Agena's side. With a 50-foot umbilical linking him to Gemini 10, Collins propelled himself to the Agena using a handheld maneuvering unit powered by compressed nitrogen. But like Gene Cernan before him, Collins soon found that carrying out his assigned task in weightlessness was far more difficult than he expected. His first attempt to grab onto the Agena left him cartwheeling in space. On the second try, he managed to hang on and retrieve the experiment. After 39 minutes outside, Collins once again returned to the cabin. The following day, Young and Collins returned to Earth, completing a 71-hour mission that gave Gemini new successes, but also some reminders of how difficult human spaceflight could be. NASA had just two more missions to work out the difficulties before the Gemini program would be over. By the summer of 1966, the time for the first manned Apollo missions was drawing near, and the Gemini program was almost over. With just two Gemini missions left, planners focused on further refining the techniques for space rendezvous. Up to now, astronauts had used a method that achieved rendezvous in four orbits after launch. But there was a quicker and more efficient technique, not yet tried, that promised a rendezvous in just one orbit. If successful, the one-orbit rendezvous technique could be used by Apollo astronauts returning from the surface of the moon to their orbiting command ship. One-orbit rendezvous became the primary objective of the Gemini 11 mission, with veteran Pete Conrad and rookie Dick Gordon. Once docked with their Agena target rocket, Conrad and Gordon would fire its engine and soar to a record height of 850 miles. But accomplishing the new rendezvous scheme would require extraordinary accuracy. Once the Agena was safely in orbit, the favorable conditions for Gemini 11's launch, called the launch window, would last just 2 seconds. On the morning of September 12, 1966, at 8:05 a.m., Gemini 11's Agena successfully reached orbit. Then, Conrad and Gordon lifted off at precisely 26.5 seconds after 9:42 a.m., only half a second late. Immediately after reaching orbit, the astronauts began their high-speed chase using their own onboard calculations. Just 85 minutes after launch, over the coast of California, Conrad and Gordon caught up with their Agena. On this first day in space, both men took some time to practice docking and undocking with the Agena. They made a test firing of its big rocket engine, and then they settled down for a night's rest. The main order of business for day two was Gordon's spacewalk. He planned to spend more than 100 minutes outside Gemini 11, performing an evaluation of space-powered tools originally scheduled for the aborted Gemini 8 flight. He would also fly around in space using a handheld maneuvering unit. But his first task was to attach a 98-foot tether from the Agena to the nose of Gemini 11. Later in the flight, the astronauts would use this tether to try and experiment in artificial gravity. Gordon had practiced attaching the tether in a special training aircraft that produced short periods of weightlessness. Because he wanted to have the use of both hands to attach the tether, Gordon straddled the nose of the Gemini, wedging his legs between the spacecraft's nose and the Agena's docking collar. From inside Gemini 11, Pete Conrad called out encouragement to his partner. But now, Gordon ran into the same problem that had thwarted Gene Cernan and Mike Collins. Doing tasks in space was much harder than the practice runs had led him to expect. Gordon had to struggle to keep his body steady while he worked. By the time he succeeded in attaching the tether, he was hot, sweaty, and exhausted. His right eye was stinging from perspiration, and Conrad called him back inside Gemini 11 after just 33 minutes outside. Once again, the problems of working in weightlessness had gotten the better of a Gemini spacewalker. The following day, Conrad and Gordon prepared for Gemini 11's high-altitude ride, stowing loose gear, putting on their helmets and gloves. Then, on their 26th orbit, they fired the Agena's rocket engine for 26 seconds. As the docked spacecraft climbed higher, the astronauts watched the Earth recede until they could see the curve of the planet. On the way up, Gordon snapped pictures for scientists of land masses and weather patterns. Then, over Australia, they reached the high point of their new orbit, 850 miles up, and enjoyed a view of Earth never before seen by human eyes.
I'll tell you, you can't believe it. Just out of my left window, I can see all the way from India, around the top of the world, all the way around the about 150 degrees, blew the horizon all the way around.
For 3 hours, Conrad and Gordon stayed in this high-flying orbit. Then, another firing of the Agena's engine brought them back down to an orbital altitude of 188 miles. There was another spacewalk by Dick Gordon, this time a two-hour stand-up EVA to take ultraviolet photographs of star fields using a special camera. In contrast to his first excursion, Gordon found his tasks leisurely, so much so that he even took a short nap while standing in Gemini 11's open hatch.
You know, we had the whole rest of the Atlantic to go with nothing to do. And so lo and behold, I fell sound asleep. And I was sound asleep in my hard suit with arms out like this, and all of a sudden I woke up and realized that not only was I asleep on the job, but I was asleep while we were depressurized. And I said, "Hey, Dick, would you believe I fell asleep?" And all I got out of him was a, "Huh, what?"
After Gordon's stand-up EVA, it was time to conduct the so-called gravity gradient experiment. After undocking from the Agena, Conrad backed away, extending the Dacron tether Gordon had attached to the Gemini's nose. At first, the tether refused to become completely straight. To Pete Conrad, it looked like a jump rope. Finally, Conrad was able to set the two spacecraft into a slow tumble and created a very weak sensation of gravity inside Gemini 11. The experiment was a success, and Conrad released the tether and left the Agena behind. On September 15th, Conrad and Gordon headed back to Earth, and in the process, scored one more accomplishment in an already successful flight. Instead of guiding the spacecraft through its fiery re-entry, the astronauts let the onboard computer do all the flying. The automatic re-entry worked well, and Gemini 11 splashed down less than 3 miles from the recovery ship USS Guam. But despite the successes of Gemini 11, the problems of working outside a spacecraft had yet to be solved. That would be the primary goal of the final Gemini mission. Taming the difficulties of EVA, NASA's term for spacewalking, was at the heart of the Gemini 12 mission, commanded by veteran Jim Lovell. The EVA tasks would fall to rookie Buzz Aldrin, a former Air Force fighter pilot who had earned a doctorate at MIT studying space rendezvous. Aldrin had helped develop the rendezvous techniques used by Gemini astronauts. Around the Space Center, he was nicknamed Dr. Rendezvous. Now he would add EVA specialist to his credentials, making three spacewalks during the Gemini 12 flight.
Just prior to the flight, the backup crew came over to me and said, Jim, you know who you're flying with? And I said, I think I do. My compatriot knows quite a bit about rendezvous. He has a doctorate in the science of related subjects. And they said, you better not bust this one.
To train for his spacewalks, Aldrin used a new technique, practicing his tasks underwater in a swimming pool at a boys' school in Baltimore, Maryland. In these sessions, Aldrin worked out details of how he would move and use equipment in space. At one time, NASA had considered rescheduling the astronaut maneuvering unit abandoned during Gene Cernan's difficult EVA on Gemini 9. But after the difficulties experienced by Mike Hollins and Dick Gordon, planners decided to go back to basics. Aldrin would evaluate new kinds of body restraints to help him maintain his position in weightlessness. He would perform simple tasks like hooking up connectors and tightening bolts. By the time launch day arrived on November 11, 1966, Aldrin was ready to confront the EVA gremlins. Gemini 12's launch on the afternoon of November 11th was flawless, but during the rendezvous with their Agena target rocket, Lovell and Aldrin ran into trouble. The onboard rendezvous radar stopped working.
We are getting set for our final maneuver down at the terminal phase initiation for the final rendezvous, when Buzz noticed that the computer wasn't given any change of range. And I had looked down at a little green light that tells us that we have a radar lock on, and it was off. And for a minute there, both of us just looked at each other. We said, oh no, it can't happen to us. Anybody else or any other time, but gee, not this time. But suddenly it dawned on us that, sure enough, our radar had indeed failed. And we went to the radar backup procedures, which we had practiced quite a bit in our pre-flight training, but really never expected to use.
So Dr. Rendezvous stepped in. Using backup charts and making sightings with a handheld sextant, Aldrin gave Lovell the necessary information to fly the rendezvous. At 4 hours and 13 minutes into the flight, Gemini 12 successfully docked. Lovell and Aldrin had planned to use their Agena's main rocket engine to raise their orbital altitude, just as the Gemini 11 crew had done. But mission controllers studying telemetry from the Agena had noticed a hiccup during the engine's test firing shortly after launch. The high-altitude ride was canceled. Instead, Lovell and Aldrin would conduct a different kind of rendezvous with a total eclipse of the sun. Using the smaller, secondary engines on the Agena, they made a slight adjustment to their orbit to bring Gemini 12 into the path of the eclipse. On the flight's second day over South America, Lovell and Aldrin became the first astronauts to witness a solar eclipse from space. Then it was time for the first of three spacewalks. For 2 hours and 20 minutes, Aldrin conducted a stand-up EVA floating in Gemini 12's open hatch.
Gemini 12, Houston Capcom, we have about 1 minute to Kano LOS. Your Vox is going flyby, and Buzz, will you confirm that you can see stars in the daylight? Over.
He took ultraviolet photos of star fields and got used to working in weightlessness. Aldrin remained comfortable the entire time he was outside, and Gemini 12's first spacewalk went perfectly.
I'm sure you're all aware that things went quite well, and of course we were very well satisfied with the progress of the EVA. As a matter of fact, things went quite a bit smoother than I had actually thought that they would. We had to anticipate many, many problems that could arise, and it was just through continual training and going over these procedures that we were able to learn what these pitfalls might be and how to avoid them.
The following day, Aldrin once again emerged from Gemini 12, this time trailing a 30-foot umbilical. Using handrails installed on Gemini 12's hull, Aldrin moved carefully to the spacecraft's nose to attach a tether between it and the Agena, the task that had exhausted Gemini 11's Dick Gordon. But Aldrin had a new method of staying anchored, short tethers that he rigged from his waist to the spacecraft. The tethers kept him in place while he attached the line from the Agena to the Gemini without difficulty. Then, after a rest, Aldrin moved to the rear of the Gemini's equipment section, where he tried a number of tasks, including using a powered wrench designed for the Apollo program. While he worked, his feet were anchored in a set of foot restraints called golden slippers, another innovation to make spacewalking easier. Then it was back to the Agena for more tasks. Finally, after two successful hours outside, Aldrin returned to Gemini 12. The spacewalking gremlins had been tamed. Later that day, Lovell and Aldrin undocked from their Agena and performed a repeat of the so-called gravity gradient experiment first tried on Gemini 11. The experiment took advantage of the fact that spacecraft at slightly different altitudes orbit at slightly different speeds. After pulling away from the Agena, Lovell was able to keep the tether taut without using fuel. The following day, Aldrin capped his EVA success with a third outing. In this hour-long stand-up EVA, he discarded unneeded gear and took more ultraviolet astronomical photos. Finally, on November 15th, after nearly 4 days in space, Gemini 12 made an automatically controlled re-entry, splashing down less than 3 miles from the carrier WASP. The Gemini program had ended. And with Gemini's completion, NASA had paved the way for Project Apollo. The Gemini missions had shown that astronauts could survive in space long enough to fly a lunar landing mission. They successfully demonstrated the techniques for space rendezvous and controlled re-entry into Earth's atmosphere. And they showed that humans could work in the vacuum of space without becoming exhausted. The bridge to the moon had been constructed. The historic successes still to come in the Apollo moon missions would owe a great debt to the pioneering flights of Project Gemini.